Thank you. Thank you. What beautiful words to bring us into worship. It's been an extraordinary week, hasn't it? And as we've come into the hall this morning, we've seen images of that week. I think the one that speaks to me most, I'm not sure if it was on the screen, but the one that speaks to me most is the rainbow above the castles, reminding us that God is in the moment. And as we come and worship this morning, as we reflect on this last week, we come knowing that God is in the moment, and we trust in Jesus' name as we share together in worship. Welcome to worship at Maidenhead, whether you're here in person or whether you're online. Welcome to our time of worship together. Just some announcements for this coming week. This is our second Sunday, so we have refreshments and a meal after this morning's meeting. And our hub is open on Tuesday and Thursday this week. And we have Wednesday, our growth group online, and Friday, the prayer time in our quiet room. Just some changes to next weekend because of the times that we find ourselves in. In National Mourning, we will not be having the Park Day next week, but we've replaced that with a community songs of praise down in Grenville Park. We want to put leaflets out to our neighbours and those of the community next Saturday. So if you have some free time and you want to come down here on Saturday, I'm going to say 10 o'clock. We haven't agreed a time, but if we say 10 o'clock next Saturday, we're going to have some leaflets, just leaflet the neighbourhood, so the community come together in this time of mourning, but also come together to celebrate a life that's been well lived. And so if you're free next Saturday morning, please come along to the hall and help us just to give those leaflets out so we can get as many people of our community sharing with that time down in the park next Sunday at 11:30. So still Grenville Park, but at 11:30 through to, I think that's 45 minutes, then we're going to have refreshments served in the hub afterwards. Some dates for the future. For Friday the 30th of September, we have our monthly pop-up charity shop, a Macmillan Coffee Morning. Margaret's still looking for cakes, volunteers, funds, anything that will help her in that day. And if you can see Margaret after, then she'll be grateful for any help and interest you have in that event. Harvest is coming up soon on Saturday, the 1st of October. We have our harvest supper in the hall. It's £5 a head, and I believe we're seeing Taryn for that. It wasn't on my list, but I think Taryn's organising that. So if you let Taryn know you'll be coming along, then we can know how many we're catering for. And then on Sunday, the 2nd of October at 10:30 is our harvest celebrations. And we're asking you to bring donations of food and produce for our harvest display. And that's going to go into our community food store afterwards. Harvest altar envelopes will also be made available shortly. And the leaders for that weekend are Majors Richard and Caroline Mingay. So we look forward to that celebration on our first weekend in October. Just some dates for the for your diary. On Sunday the 13th of, I put September, but it's November, is our Remembrance Day service, and that's going to commence at
10:45.
So a different change to our meeting time then. And then just notes for your diary. Core Anniversary Weekend, which is on the 19th and 20th of November, and that's going to be led by our divisional leaders, Majors Mike and Lisa Lloyd-Jones. Saturday evening, there's going to be a music concert, but more details will be made available shortly on that. So just a date for your diary then. Just some core news. Derek Jones did return home. He's gone back into hospital. He's in Wexham Park still. So please remember Derek and the family in your prayers at this time, so we support him as he needs the medical attention, and we pray for his recovery. Thank you for listening. We look forward to a time of worship and sharing together.
We
for those of you who may not be aware, it's Janet's birthday today. I was going to do that at the end of the meeting, but David stole the show. So happy birthday for today, Janet. We do meet together in extraordinary circumstances this morning, as Rob has said. And so our second Sunday celebration will be perhaps a little bit different to what I'd planned. What I'd planned will come back in October instead. And we're going to spend some time reflecting on the life of our Queen and celebrating the life of service that she gave to our country. It's an end of an era in many ways, isn't it? The passing of one of the world's most famous and faithful Christian leaders. And you may have your own thoughts about the institution of monarchy, but today, as we have been over the last few days, millions of people are lamenting the loss of a woman whose public service and Christian witness shone brightly for more than 70 years. Let's just pray for a moment. King of Kings, we give you thanks today for the life and faith of your servant, our sister Elizabeth. As countless people remember her life and legacy, may we be inspired as we gather in worship today to live for you in the service of others for as long as we may live. Amen. It's clear, isn't it, from what we have seen and heard over the last few days, that the Queen's Christian faith was very important to her. And on Christmas Day 1952, in her first Christmas broadcast, she said to the nation and to the Commonwealth, "Pray for me, that God may give me wisdom and strength to carry out the solemn promises I should be making, and that I may faithfully serve him and you all the days of my life." And as we meet together this morning, we say that prayer was answered, don't we? Elizabeth would make a series of solemn promises 6 months later at her coronation, and she kept those faithfully for over 70 years. The newly crowned Queen promised three things in her coronation: to govern appropriately, to maintain justice, and to profess the gospel of Christ. And this she surely did until her final breath. We are going to sing together our first song in a few moments. One of the things that you may have noticed over the last few days, and there's been lots of events going on, is that the Prime Minister and a few other senior parliamentarians yesterday swore a new allegiance to His Majesty the King, King Charles III. Well, we and some of those have a higher allegiance, don't we? And so in our first song, song 686, if you're using the songbook, we're going to sing, "Unto Thee, O Saviour King, our allegiance we bring." But just to prepare us to sing that song, we're going to watch this video of the Queen's life of service.
We must give nothing less than the whole of ourselves.
To do all we can to help our gallant sailors, soldiers, and airmen. And we are trying, too, to bear our own share of the danger and sadness of war.
The heiress to the throne carried out her first public engagement and her first military inspection.
Thank you.
with all my life and with all my heart, I shall strive to be worthy of your trust. With an unwavering faith, a high courage, and a quiet heart, we shall be able to make of this ancient commonwealth, which we all love so dearly, an even grander thing.
Together then, unto thee, O Saviour King, our allegiance now we bring. Thank you. Please be seated.
They teach us all a lesson, just as the Christmas story does, that in the birth of a child, there is a new dawn with endless potential. It is this simplicity of the Christmas story that makes it so universally appealing. Simple happenings that form the starting point of the life of Jesus, a man whose teachings have been handed down from generation to generation and have been the bedrock of my faith. His birth marked a new beginning. As the carol says, the hopes and fears of all the years are met in thee tonight.
Be clear, particularly over the last few years, that Christ was the Queen's cornerstone, as the Sing Cymru have reminded us this morning. Faith was very important to her personally and as our monarch. Let's pray together. Gracious God, as we gather together this morning, we give you thanks for the reign of your servant Elizabeth, our Queen. We thank you for the example of loving and faithful service which she has shown among us. As we gather together, our hearts and our minds also turn to the royal family. We pray for your comfort and your peace to surround them all as they grieve the loss of their loved one, our Queen. We pray for her children, her grandchildren, and all her family members and friends. We remember too her staff and all who worked closely with her, including members of our own congregation. We thank you for the Queen's service, her lifelong devotion to duty to the United Kingdom and our Commonwealth of Nations. We remember her appreciation of the Salvation Army and the occasions when she was able to recognise and support our work. In these moments, we pray especially for her son Charles, our King, as he assumes his great responsibilities at this time of sorrow. During these days of great change and challenge in our country, may we each find strength and courage together in communities, loving God and loving others in the name of Christ, the King of Kings. And as we worship together this morning, will you help us to follow her example of dedication and to commit our lives to you and to one another, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. As an extension of that prayer, we sing together, "In my life be glorified," in the same way as Christ was glorified in the Queen's life. "In my life be glorified, in our church be glorified." Let's sing these two verses together. As I mentioned in our prayer this morning, the Queen and the Salvation Army came into contact on a number of occasions, and for the Platinum Jubilee, Territorial Headquarters produced a short video of some of those occasions. So we'll remind ourselves of those now before we turn to our Bible reading for this morning. There we go, some lovely memories for us as an organisation in the days to come. Our Bible reading this morning, if you've got your Bible with you or if you're sharing on an app, is Mark chapter 10 and verses 35 to 45. Mark chapter 10 and verses 35 to 45. Jesus teaches about serving others. Then James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came over and spoke to him. "Teacher," they said, "we want you to do us a favor." "What is your request?" he asked. They replied, "When you sit on your glorious throne, we want to sit in places of honor next to you, one on your right and the other on your left." But Jesus said to them, "You don't know what you are asking. Are you able to drink from the bitter cup of suffering I am about to drink? Are you able to be baptized with the baptism of suffering I must be baptized with?" "Oh yes," they replied, "we are able." Then Jesus told them, "You will indeed drink from my bitter cup and be baptized with my baptism of suffering. But I have no right to say who will sit on my right or my left. God has prepared those places for the ones he has chosen." When the 10 other disciples heard what James and John had asked, they were indignant. So Jesus called them together and said, "You know that the rulers in this world lord it over their people, and officials flaunt their authority over those under them. But among you, it will be different. Whoever wants to be a leader among you must be your servant, and whoever wants to be first among you must be the slave of everyone else. For even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve others, and to give his life as a ransom for many." Amen. We'll come back to those words in a few moments, but first, we'll take up the offering, please.
Shall we pray? Father God, we do thank you for all the riches you've given us. We thank you for the service of Elizabeth, and we pray that she is with you now and you are celebrating her return. But Lord, we offer today what little that we can. It may only be little in terms of what you've given us, but Lord, we do pray that you will use it and bless it in the extension of your kingdom.
On the 5th of February this year, on the 70th anniversary of her accession to the throne, Her Majesty the Queen issued a letter. She could have taken any number of themes. She could have looked back and taken the opportunity to celebrate 70 years on the throne. She could have looked back at all that had happened in those 70 years. And she would have justly felt a sense of achievement. But that's not what she wrote about. Instead, on the 70th anniversary of her accession to the throne, our Queen renewed her pledge to give her life devoted to our service. How the world sees power so often. So many people in power use that power to, as Jesus said in that Bible reading, to lord it over people, to lord it over those that they're responsible for. Jesus says they flaunt their authority. And we look around the world today, and that's what we see, isn't it? So often in our leaders. We see in our news leaders who are prepared to go to war, to trample over another country for more power, for more authority. We've seen a leader who's willing to incite a riot in order to try to cling on to power. We've seen over the last few weeks politicians who are willing to go through a bruising election process in order to win power. Across the world, we see governments and leaders who are willing to oppress their people in order to cling on to power and so on. That's how the world views power so often. Human beings often dream of power and position. Nobody ever dreams of giving service. And that's what Jesus' disciples show in this particular episode. The irony, the absolute irony, is that until this point in Mark chapter 10, Jesus has spent a significant amount of time telling his disciples about what is about to happen to him, about the condemnation that he is about to suffer, about the humiliation that is going to come to him, and the fact that he will die an excruciating death on the cross. And what's the disciples' response? Well, James and John in verse 37 say, "When you sit on your glorious throne, we want to sit in places of honor next to you, one on your right and the other on your left." Are these people stupid? It sounds it, doesn't it? Yeah. Are these people stupid? Jesus has just been telling them about what he's about to go through, and that is their response. What a picture of human vanity. What a picture of ambition and seeking your own benefit rather than the benefit of others. I'm pretty sure that James and John would never have signed a letter, "Your servant." It's laughable, isn't it? Until we stop and think for a moment. Aren't we a bit like James and John? Aren't we all sons of Zebedee? Of course, we might not have made such an outlandish request after Jesus has been talking about death and condemnation. But if we're honest, we do often want the best seats in the house. Many of us do have ambition. Many of us have had our career mapped out where we want to get to. We want a nice house and a good salary. We want this church to be large and full. We want our children to be high achievers. Some of us even want the reputation as a good preacher. Maybe that's just me. But it's part of our human condition. And Jesus teaches his disciples that there is only one cure for this need for power and authority. And in verses 43 and 45, he says, "But among you it will be different. Whoever wants to be a leader among you must be your servant, and whoever wants to be first among you must be the slave of everyone else. Why? For even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve others, and to give his life as a ransom for many." If we want to be transformed from the sons of Zebedee, the kind of people who want to cling on to power and gain more power and authority and become children of God, then Jesus says that only happens through service, through servanthood. Right at the beginning of his ministry, these disciples, including James and John, had been invited to follow Jesus. And immediately before this conversation in Mark chapter 10, between James and John and Jesus, Jesus had invited the rich young ruler to follow him. Following Jesus involves a life of servanthood. Jesus encourages his followers to resist the human system of domination, of exercising power over others. He says, resist trying to control others. Resist ranking people in a hierarchy, says the captain. Resist a life of winners and losers, of insiders and outsiders, of the honored and the ashamed. It's absolutely clear that Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth understood and accepted these words of Jesus. Just last month, on the 3rd of August 2022, the Queen said these words. It was her Christian faith, that cornerstone that the Singh Company reminded us of, that kept her going for 70 years. We will never know how truly ill she was on Tuesday when she welcomed her 15th Prime Minister. But because of her example in Christ, because of her devotion to Christ, her devotion to duty, she kept going to the very end. She simply tried to serve God and do her best for him each day, serving us as our sovereign. Throughout her life, Her Majesty the Queen turned the world's ideas of power and glory upside down and inside out, just as Jesus said his followers should. As I said at the beginning of the meeting, she's been one of the most famous and faithful Christian leaders of all time, certainly in our lifetimes. And her public service, her Christian service, has shone brightly around the world. The question for each of us this morning is simply, will we follow her example? Whatever station we have in life, will we live humble lives? Are we willing to ask God to grow in us servant hearts, to give us a servant's attitude to our relationship with others? Will we be willing to help others as needed? Will we spend the time appreciating other people's worth? Will we realize that whatever our station in life, we're not above doing any job? Will we pledge to work together in teams rather than worrying about our status or our authority? Will we try not to be jealous of others, but simply to fulfill our own duties, our own purpose that God has given us, to serve sacrificially, to carry out God's mission of sharing Jesus' good news with the world. In short, to follow the wonderful example of Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II and the perfect example of Jesus our servant leader. As we give thanks for the Queen's life and service this morning, in our worship and over the next few days, let's also ask God to challenge us with her example. We're going to take a few moments to reflect. Those of you who want to, I invite you to come forward and to light a tea light in memory of our Queen, but not just in memory of our Queen, giving thanks to God for her life and her service, but also to take the opportunity to ask God what he wants us to do in service for others, in helping people in any way that we can. There'll be some quiet music. Please come forward as you feel led this morning.
We should take comfort that while we may have more still to endure, better days will return. We will be with our friends again. We will be with our families again. We will meet again.
And we believe that, don't we? As God's people, we will meet Her Majesty the Queen again one day. We've had a time of reflection, but this is our second Sunday celebration, and so I didn't want to end on too somber a mood. So perhaps you'll remember this from just a few months ago. So there we go. Now we have our marmalade sandwiches. And now that we're all aware that it's Janet's birthday today, we will sing happy birthday to Janet properly. So let's sing together. And we will stand to sing our final song together, reminding us that as we go from here to serve, following the example of Jesus and Her Majesty the Queen, we go with God's presence. If your presence doesn't go with us, then don't send us up from here. Let's stand. It's song 1031 if you're using a songbook.
Thank you.
Amen. This is the God we adore, our faithful, unchangeable friend, whose love is as great as his power, and neither knows measure nor end. 'Tis Jesus, the first and the last, whose spirit shall guide us safe home. We'll praise him for all that is past, and trust him for all that's to come. Amen. Before the sing company sing a benediction to us, I invite you to remain standing as we sing together the national anthem along with us. Please be seated.